thank you all for joining the GNLCC webinar. Please be advised that you are on mute, so if you have any questions, please type them into the questions panel of the control panel of your GoToWebinar. So we're very pleased to have Zach Bowen, who is an applied ecologist at the Fort Collins Science Center, join us today. Zach works on multiple interagency projects and is the science team lead for the Wyoming Landscape Conservation Initiative. So Zach, whenever you're ready, feel free to take it away.
Okay. Well, I sure appreciate everybody taking the time out of their day to participate here. What I'm going to talk about is work that's been going on since about 2007 in southwest Wyoming. And the emphasis here is going to be on the initiative, the Wyoming Landscape Conservation Initiative, and how it might be a useful part of the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative. Now, I'd like to start off with recognizing that what I'm presenting here is actually the work of a whole lot of people. And this list is probably not accurate now. There's probably a name or two that's wrong, but the point is that there are a lot of people that are participating on the USGS science team, and it's the collective body of work that makes up the science and technical assistance for the WLCI. Just to give you a sort of preview of what I'm going to talk about, basically I'm going to start with what might normally be presented at the end. I want to make sure everybody sees this in case people have to check out for whatever reason. So I'm going to put up some of the important summary points right at the beginning, and that what I see those as are the places where the Great Northern and the WLCI have shared priorities, in places where the WLCI might be able to make some positive contributions to the Great Northern. Next, I'll talk some about Southwest Wyoming and the initiative itself, sort of the purpose, why the WLCI got started. I'll shift and talk a little bit more in depth about the science and technical assistance that the USGS science team is providing for the WLCI. I'll show you an integrated assessment. We've been working on this for over a year now, and I think it's got some themes that might be relevant to the Great Northern and the overall idea of looking at multiple resources in one view and using that to help define priorities is something I think that is common to both the WLCI and the Great Northern. And then I'll kind of wrap up with sort of funneling back out to the larger world of initiatives and assessments that are going on right now, and maybe how we can work together and try and keep some of these as coordinated as they can be. So this is, again, kind of the summary points. Probably the most obvious thing I saw when I reviewed the draft strategy document for the Great Northern and thought about the WLCI was basically the region-wide and also the sagebrush step-specific conservation priority themes of landscape integrity and habitat connectivity. Those are common to both the Great Northern and the WLCI, and that's a really important sort of overarching theme that's present in both the initiatives. Similarly, I looked at the focal species and resources for the Great Northern, and I believe almost all of those were similarly focal species or resources for Southwest Wyoming as part of the WLCI. And then finally, in terms of the shared priorities, the stressors and impacts that were mentioned in the strategy document for the Great Northern, all those are being studied as part of the WLCI as well. And then I thought through, these were just kind of off the top of my head in terms of potential contributions that could be made to the Great Northern from the WLCI. The biggest one, I think, and probably one of the most important, is we've spent a lot of time, really years, building relationships and partnerships and getting the WLCI going. And we, I think, can bring those to the table for the Great Northern. There also is a really large body of existing work, and this includes all the things you do when you start an initiative, charters and vision statements and plans and the organizational charts, all the steps you go through. We've done a lot of that, and we've learned a fair amount about things we did well and could have done better in setting up the WLCI. Going back to the earlier slides, that there's a pretty clearly defined set of both conservation and science priorities for the WLCI, and these are obviously centered on sagebrush steppe. There are other focal ecosystems in the WLCI, but sagebrush steppe is the vast majority of the area. There are lots and lots of science and technical assistance products that have been developed for the WLCI, and I think a lot of these would be of interest, and you can see them. The most recent annual report we have done for the WLCI is 2010, and there's an address there. I'll leave this for just a second in case anybody wants to write that down or copy it. Like I mentioned earlier, I'll talk a little bit about this integrated assessment. Basically, it's people talk about decision support systems. I think this falls into that category. And the idea was to put the resources that are important for the WLCI in one place and allow people to use those as a tool for planning for conservation actions. And that's the beta website is available now. And if people would be interested in looking at it, we're looking for feedback and comments. So if you happen to look at that site and see things that make sense or don't make sense, we'd sure like to hear about it. Number six, this is a pretty big one too. There are two applications that have been developed for data management and sharing, one for the LCC and one for the WLCI. They are both in the same domain in terms of their science-based applications. So the root program that both of the WLCI and the Great Northern data management systems are built on, that root application is the same. And what this means, I think, is it will be relatively easy, if desired, to share the data back and forth between the initiatives if we wanted to do that. And then last one, I actually did just stop because I thought this list could get really, really long, so I quit at that point. The meta point is there's a lot that's been done, and I think a lot of it's directly applicable to the Great Northern, and if not applicable, it might be of interest. So I'll talk just real briefly about Southwest Wyoming. People that, might be folks on the phone that are very familiar already. Wyoming has some of the nation's most productive gas fields right now. And in terms of domestic energy supply, Wyoming is the largest entity supplying energy to the U.S. There's natural gas, oil, wind, coal, uranium. In terms of minerals, the largest trona mine in the United States is in Wyoming, in the WLCI area. So there's tremendous natural resource potential. And if you look at the two graphs on the right, the one that's got the red histogram, that is a billion cubic feet of gas on the y-axis, and on the x-axis, it's years. And when I pulled this, it's from the Wyoming Oil and Gas Commission. It was some of their projections. They had done this, I think, in about 2006 or 7, somewhere in there, and projected out to 2035. You can see the trend, and then if you notice, there's a little triangle above maybe 2008 or so. projection. The little triangle is actually a data point. I went and looked at what the production was for that year. The point here is the projections are probably not far off, and these numbers have pretty real implications for what happens on the landscape in Wyoming. And then the graph on the underneath the histogram is wind development in Wyoming. On the y-axis is number of turbines and year on the x-axis. Wind is sort of the newcomer in Wyoming. Wyoming has, in addition to these tremendous gas resources, some of the best wind potential in the coterminous United States. This is just now really taking off, and there are multiple wind facilities in the planning stage right now. There's one that's going to be located, if you know the area between Rawlins and Saratoga, potentially a 1,000 turbine facility. So some of these are pretty big, and it's really sort of in the exponential growth phase. Well, sort of in the same area here, we have some of the best habitats near Mountain West, especially for mule deer and sage grouse in terms of your charismatic megafauna. And roughly half of the remaining sage grouse are in Wyoming, and most of those are in southwest Wyoming. So it's a really important area for sagebrush steppe obligate species. There are over 1,700 family farms and ranches. These are really important because they help maintain these big open spaces that are important for wildlife, and they also help define the place in terms of the people and what's important in Wyoming. And then, very importantly, in southwest Wyoming, about 72% of the land is publicly managed. So you put these things together, you have some of the best energy resources in the country, some of the best sagebrush steppe wildlife habitat, and you also have the majority of the land publicly managed. So that's essentially the set of things that led the WLCI to start. People in Wyoming were beginning to get a little concerned about what was happening. They wanted to try and do some good things for fish and wildlife while still producing energy. And the other part here is because so much of the land is publicly managed, the decisions that get made are going to have a real effect on what happens with both wildlife and energy development. So, like I said, people were seeing the development occurring. The pace was different than what a lot of people who had lived there for generations had seen before. The director of the then director of BLM and the director of Wyoming Game and Fish did a lot of the work to get this started from the bottom up. And at the same time, Department of Interior was launching their Healthy Lands Initiative. And these two things came together and started the WLCI. The purpose of the WLCI, or the goal, you can see it there and read it, long-term science-based effort to enhance aquatic and terrestrial habitats and facilitate energy development. The people in the picture, now some of these folks have changed, but the partners have not. And the far left is the head of Wyoming Game and Fish. The next lady represents the conservation districts in Wyoming. Next individual is the head of Department of Agriculture for the state. Next was head for a representative for the county commissioners in Wyoming, the head of the ES office for Fish and Wildlife Service, and the head of the Wyoming BLM state office. And you see the stickers on the website, little screen grab, those represent the partners in the WLCI. And all this was put together with an MOU and got it set up, I believe it was in 2007, 2008. There's an address for the website. If you go to the website, you can read a lot more about the initiative. The real purpose of the initiative, you know, the habitat projects are what most people view as the guts of the WLCI. And right now, most of the funding to do these habitat projects comes through BLM and U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. We recently got some external funding from the Ruby Pipeline Company, and that's also going to be used to do habitat projects. And these projects are scattered around the WLCI area. I don't have, you know, all the dots up. The map's a little old, but there are about 54 that have been done since 2007 and 27 proposed for 12. They include a range of things, treatments in aspen, fencing, wetlands, conservation easements, forage reserves, and a lot more different types of projects. And the idea is these projects would benefit multiple species, and there are some examples there. The projects get started from the ground up. They start with local project development teams. These are organized around the WLCI area. They include, they're open to anyone, these LPDTs are, and they include landowners and agency folks and other interested people. They come together and talk about priorities, and they develop the proposals for the habitat projects. An important part of this is that the funding is highly leveraged. The funding that comes through the WLCI is almost always leveraged with dollars from other entities. Sometimes these include NGOs, state agencies, conservation districts, etc. The list on the right, that's the coordination team. The coordination team is sort of the heart and soul of the initiative. They are the people that are dedicated full-time or nearly full-time to working on the WLCI. And they serve as sort of the center of mass for all these other teams and entities that work on WLCI. When the initiative was starting, we, USGS, was asked to provide the science and technical assistance to support the WLCI. So we started off with the question of what's the most important work we can do to support the initiative. And even though there's just a short list of bullet items here, it probably took about a year to come up with this list. And there's more to it than that. Of course, there's write-ups that go with each of these bullet items. The point is, the list represents the most important management needs as identified by all those partners that we looked at earlier. And you can read what those are. And I think you'll see quite a few of these priority management needs overlapping with the Great Northern. USGS, as I mentioned, was brought into the initiative specifically to provide research and technical assistance. And one way I like to think about it is we're trying to help answer some pretty basic questions. Why, for example, what about the objectives? Why are we considering doing a habitat treatment in a certain place? Where is the most important place in terms of a priority to, for example, connect sagebrush habitats? What is the most effective method? How do we know that? And finally, you know, is it working? Are the habitat projects working individually? And then if you tried to look across the WLCI landscape, is the initiative working? We're trying to think about things at these two very different scales. And the three bullet items there basically describe what we're trying to do. We want to address management needs because that's why we were brought to the table. We want to advance science in Southwest Wyoming. We're a science agency. That's part of our job, too, and we want to make sure what we do is transferable. We developed a science strategy document. That's the top right. That's available online if people want to look at it. And the little pyramid, basically that's a cartoon of our approach. We built a framework for doing the science and technical assistance on the management needs. And it includes these different types of activities. These are classes of activities, the synthesis, research and monitoring, and coordination. And then we have the information management and decision-making kind of going across all three of those levels. I'm going to talk very, very briefly about these different themes that we're working on. In each of these themes, there are multiple projects. The baseline synthesis was designed to seek out and find everything we could in terms of existing data for Southwest Wyoming. We got told over and over, you know, make sure we're not recreating the wheel, we're not collecting data that someone already has. So we spent a fair amount of effort, and it's a continual effort. We're still doing it, trying to keep a current catalog and set of data sets for Southwest Wyoming. These include things like on the left, that's all the oil and gas wells. On the right, that's just a current range map for grouse based on some data from the natural diversity database. Effectiveness monitoring is another component, and basically when we say effectiveness, we're looking at the effectiveness of the habitat treatments. In this case, the illustrations represent the treatment that was done in aspen to remove conifers, and the aspen are important for a variety of wildlife species, ungulates, and importantly, they're a stopover habitat for migratory birds, including some neotropical migrants. And the idea is the yellow dots represent places where we went out and sampled vegetation, cover, composition, et cetera, and then you repeat those samples after the treatment and then go back and look at it over time and see what the effects of the treatment were. There's a long-term monitoring component that we're responsible for. This includes water. There are gauges in the WLCI that are supported with WLCI funding. There are also groundwater wells that we're sampling specifically to look at oil and gas development. One of the major components that we're contributing to this long-term monitoring effort for the WLCI is looking at vegetation change over time and with different activities on the ground. We've come up with, from quite a few years of work with folks at AROS, a method for looking at these eight components of sagebrush ecosystems, and you can see what those are, shrub cover, sagebrush, et cetera. And what's interesting here is these are all continuous cover maps. Prior to this method being developed, looked at a map of sagebrush, it was binary. It was either sagebrush or not. And each of these components were predicting a percentage. And in the lower right, you can see how, looking from 88 to 2006, you can see the red blob representing a decrease in sagebrush. And from 88 to 06 in the imagery, you can see the same square shape. It was obviously either burned or treated with the herbicide as part of some of BLM's management. The point is you can use these methods to look at vegetation change over time. And the big idea here is we're looking at long-term monitoring, particularly for the terrestrial world, as an interagency effort. And we have tried to define some roles for USGS and the WLCI, and some of these might make sense for expanding the interagency effort to include the Great Northern and some of the priorities for the conservation. Serving as a hub for monitoring data in and out, again, thinking of this as interagency. We want to make sure we're capturing what's already being monitored by Game and Fish, perhaps by BLM and others, and pulling that together with our remote sense data products to tell a more complete story over time. So that's our big contribution is this remote sense based monitoring. We can also help support the cooperative data sharing, data analysis. We can develop local or regional specialized designs, and then can also house and disseminate information. These are some of the things we're thinking about as our roles for the WLCI. Another theme we're working on are mechanistic studies. These are aimed at getting at cause and effect. And in this case, the pictures and graphs are about mule deer. this work was done in cooperation with the co-op unit in Wyoming and a fellow named Hall Sawyer. They put GPS collars on mule deer and looked at migration. And if you look at the map in the lower right, you can see the white dots represent, the white squares represent summer range. The brown and red represent migration corridors based on the GPS collar data. The blue outlined area is winter range. So you've got the deer starting up in the mountains in the summer and then migrating down to their winter range over time. And importantly, you can also see some polygons with straight edges on them. These are proposed energy development areas, and you can see some of these are in the corridor. And the idea here is just being able to identify this is important, because then we can start thinking about what might be done to mitigate the effect, either creating more attractive corridors, adjusting the boundaries of the development, or some combination. But that's the idea with the mechanistic studies, is looking at specific cause and effect relationships and how those might be used as part of the initiative to make better conservation decisions. And the graph in the top right is basically showing elevation in NDVI and distance from winter range, and I won't spend much time on it. Basically, the deer are following the green up down the hill. They're migrating based on vegetation availability, forage. So I'm going to spend a few minutes now. I'll go through this kind of quickly. This is the idea of putting things together into one package that can be useful for prioritizing habitat conservation. And in Southwest Wyoming, we called it the integrated assessment. And what it is a analysis of things that are important to the people in the WLCI community, and it's based on the best available data information. We see it as something that can be used to support conservation planning, and importantly, you can pull it apart and use the components to address specific questions. We're still working on it. We see it as an iterative process, and very importantly, it's not a decision. It's just something that can help people think about their own priorities and decisions. We tried to come up with some principles here. You notice the little the picture in the bottom right. It's real easy when you start doing this to pile so much stuff into this kind of an assessment that you can't ever finish it, and you can't ever use it, because you're always trying to make it better. So one of our principles here was to keep it simple, and that's relative, because it's darn near impossible to do that. But starting at the top, we wanted to focus on the WLCI priorities, use the best available data, try to make it useful for multiple purposes, make it transparent what we were doing, and people could pull apart a score for an index and see why the score was high or low. Already said, keep it simple and be consistent. The idea here is we want to use the same data that Game and Fish is using in their analyses, for example, so that when people look at something we're doing, they see that it meshes or at least uses the same basic data as other agencies, and then improve in steps. We had to define some terms here. We called resource value. These are priority areas based on, for example, Wyoming Game and Fish priorities. They're also special management areas, ACECs, wilderness study areas, other areas that have some designated protection from other management agencies. Condition, we're talking more about the focal habitat, species, and indicators of condition. The multi-criteria index, we put those first two items together. Change agents are basically the existing mapped development. Future changes is some estimated risk based on what we know about plans or potential for development. And the idea here is for each of these index scores, for example, resource value, it's a hierarchical approach where you can take that single score for the resource value and pull it apart into an aquatic and a terrestrial component. And each of the colored boxes below, for example, special management areas, is composed of some more basic data inputs, and that's what's represented in the white box to the right. In this case, it's wilderness study areas, areas of critical environmental concern, Park Service lands, fish lands, Forest Service wilderness, other protected properties and easements, and areas that have sage-grouse stipulations. Those all feed into this score for a special management area. And we normalized all these like 0 to 1 so that you can kind of compare things across the different components. And now that you see how that works, I'm not going to spend a lot of time going through the rest of these, but it's a similar hierarchy for condition, and you can see what went into the condition score, both for aquatic and terrestrial. And you wind up with maps that look like this. In this case, this is terrestrial condition, darker colors meaning higher scores, and this is based on 30-meter raster data. And you can also take those data and summarize them in a way that is more meaningful a lot of times at this scale, which is, in this case, by watershed. In this case, it's level 6 or 12-digit HUCs. So you can take those scores and summarize them by watershed and then put them in bins, low, moderate, high. And we just did this as, you know, an example. There's, you can do this lots of different ways. But the point is you start seeing places that have perhaps higher scores than others. The same thing for the terrestrial index. You can put them together, in this case, the multi-criteria index, and then you can start thinking about what might be affecting those resources. And for change agents, these are the categories of things and the data that we use to look at change agents. So we had roads, energy, mines, and urban, and you can see the data that went into those. And develop a similar map where you have the highest effect of more or less is human activity on the landscape. And you can see the if you're familiar, the I-80 corridor kind of runs from east to west across that map. And then some of the other bright red areas are associated with energy development. We also looked at future change, and in this case, we looked at energy, oil, gas, coal, wind, minerals, climate. We looked at what the projections were for climate change and invasive species. We had a model for cheatgrass potential, and then urban, we basically just buffered out existing urban areas. So you come up with a map for future change, and then you can start putting these together. And this is just a simple example where we're looking at our change agents, where the score for those is the highest, and where the score for our multi-criteria index is the highest. You start seeing places where you've got the overlap, and these maps might be useful in helping to think about priority areas, priority watersheds. And here's an example that has that multi-criteria index and the future change layer. And I just drew a little arrow there and said connectivity because you've got one watershed that's got a high potential for change in the future. And if you go back up to this previous map, you can see that it might be important in maintaining connectivity across a whole series of watersheds. I don't know if this is important or not, but the idea was to illustrate the point. And then the other big purpose we see in doing this kind of work is in pulling together all the information for this assessment, we also wind up with a great data resource. And you can just look at parts and pieces of this to answer specific questions. In this case, how many allotments in the WLCI have authorized wind leases? And we did this a little while ago, so it's not real current. But it looks like there's about 66 of them. And where are they? Well, they're the ones that are highlighted in blue. And this is just an example, but you can come up with these kinds of specific questions and see what you can do with the data that were used to build the overall integrated assessment. And this IA is now put together in a web application. This is a screen grab, and I'm going to be really daring here, and I'm going to see if the whole application actually works on the webinar. So this is hazardous at a couple of levels. First step is to find my mouse. So this is what it looks like on the screen. This is live right now, and the idea is, in this case, we're looking at that multi-criteria index with the green being the higher scores, the red being the lower scores, and you can pick a watershed within the WLCI area, and you get a pop-up. And if you think back to those sort of colorful hierarchy slides I showed earlier, multi-criteria index is decomposed here into the resource index, the multi-criteria index, for both aquatic and terrestrial. Similarly, you can look at condition, and you can see all the subscores for the things that go into that condition index. And the same with each of the other major scores that we had in our approach that I showed you with the other slides. The point here is we're trying to keep this as transparent as we can so that people can look at a watershed, see a score, and then drill down into the data and understand more about why the score is what it is. And then over here also, you'll notice there's some other things you can do. These are all basic sort of GIS, simple map overlay things. If you, for example, want to just see who owned land where, you can turn on, land ownership and see, where the different ownerships are, whether it's private BLM, Forest Service, et cetera. And you can also download data. In this case, you should see the same hierarchy that we looked at in those slides that's in the pop-up. It's also over here in the data, where if you wanted to download the individual files that went into the assessment, you can do that. And then, your GIS analyst can do their own work using these data. So that's a little bit about the integration in terms of the data and how we're trying to pull it together. And I wanted to finish up here with just a few thoughts on integration and connections. Really, the integrating the data, the technical part, it's not real easy, but it's very doable. The bigger challenge and what I think the real integration is, mostly it's among people, and those people are, in the case of the WLCI, and I think with the Great Northern, they're from different agencies. They've got very different missions and different scorecards for demonstrating how they're succeeding. And the important thing is getting those people working together and having that common purpose. We're also integrating managers and scientists, and this takes time. There's a lot of work and effort that goes into sort of mutual understanding of what's most important and how does it need to be presented. And it's a never-ending process. We're always learning. Within the science community, we're integrating across individuals that have very different technical content knowledge areas. And what I mean is you can put a world-class sage-grouse biologist in the same room with the person that knows most about natural gas development, and it takes a little while for those individuals to start understanding one another, and that's another really important point of integration here. Spatial scales, this is always a challenge, and it's going to be a challenge with any large initiative. I might have forgot to mention that the WLCI area is about 19 million acres. It's roughly the size of South Carolina. So we want to be thinking at that scale, but we also need to make sure we're thinking at the scale of an individual habitat project, which could be tens of hectares, because that's a scale that matters to a lot of people. Finally, we're trying to integrate across multiple societal needs and resource values, and this is another pretty big challenge because people want to both protect the things that are important in Southwest Wyoming in terms of natural resources, but people also recognize how important the state is for domestic energy production. So trying to integrate those needs and come up with alternatives that might make the most sense. That's another big point of integration. And then this is next to the last slide. So what are some of the connections? I guess I'd like to leave people thinking about, we're talking here about the Great Northern and the WLCI. The pictures in the bottom right also includes the BLM's Rapid Eco Regional Assessment. And you can think of these as, the Great Northern covering the largest area of the Wyoming Basin, Rapid Eco Regional Assessment's smaller, but still a sizable area, and then the WLCI fits within the, more or less, within the basin. But there's actually a lot more than that. Wyoming, the state, has come up with their own decision support tool that looks and feels not that different than what we're trying to do for the WLCI. Wyoming BLM is investing many millions of dollars with Argonne National Lab to do a wind power project looking at siting for wind turbines in the state. There's the LCCs, the Fish and Wildlife Service Region 6 has their own decision support tool called the Landscape Energy Assessment Project that's tailored to their needs. Western Governor's Corridors Project, TNC, is doing a lot of work, and of course the BLM. The reason I'm calling all these out is people often say, well, don't duplicate efforts. Well, that's our goal, is to not do that. We want to share and leverage information and all the hard work that's being done. The reality is, though, that many of these entities have specific missions, objectives, and goals that they have to address, so they wind up taking similar data and producing products that fit their own needs, and that's what we see here. One of the really important connections that was brought out to us by multiple people is to try and be as consistent as we can, where we don't wind up with confounding models or confounding decision support tools. That's going to be a challenge, but I think the more that we stay connected with one another and the more we have people working across these initiatives, the more efficient and successful we're going to be. And there's a pretty picture. That means it's all over.